thing that I really need to talk about tonight is to say thank yous. And when you see the list of thank yous that I have, you realize that running a museum like this takes so many people. And we greatly appreciate the support of all of you who are here tonight attending our events. We are so appreciative of our members. Many of you are members already. We're in the middle of a membership drive. Surprise, surprise. You might have gotten a few emails from us. So some of you have joined tonight. Thank you. We do have forms in the back if you'd like to sign up. It means the world to us to have you as our members and to have your support. So thank you for that. There are two very important people to thank here tonight. This is our newest exhibit opening right now. The turnout's fantastic. It's a really festive night in Stowe on this last day of what we're lovingly calling Snowvember this year. It wasn't mine, but I really liked it. You know, of all groups, right, Ski and Snowboard Museum, to embrace all the snow in November here. So we're delighted to have you all here on this festive night. It's a beautiful building. This is my first exhibit opening, and it's really means a lot to me that the two people who have sponsored this exhibit entirely are Jan and Chuck Perkins. They're right over here. Both of them, not only for the sponsoring of this exhibit, for their support of me. You might notice when you come in, it is called the Perkins Building. So to say that they have been instrumental in this museum before it even moved to Stowe, and then certainly in its moving here to Stowe. So thank you for that and for your support. As you can tell, it's really meaningful. It's so clear tonight that people want to share their stories, and the stories of the 10th Mountain Division are compelling and important. We really appreciate that, and that's one of the reasons for having this exhibit. As you know, we had an exhibit here, and you may not know, but we had an exhibit in 2013 on the 10th, and many members, all the members from Vermont were inducted into our Hall of Fame. So we want to build on the stories that we have at this museum, and our keeper and collector of the stories is Meredith Scott, who we will thank in just a second, because first I have to thank some other people. We have had some wonderful in-kind sponsors. The Green Mountain Inn could not be better neighbors. They are amazing. They even shovel for us. I know exactly. So thank you to them for their hospitality sponsorship. Commodore's has been wonderful in supplying rooms for some of our guests. Collective Arts Brewing has been a sponsor, a beer sponsor of our events and exhibits. We have Red Bench events that I'm sure many of you are hearing about. We hope you come to the next one, which is on Thursday. It's about the history of the Mount Mansfield Ski Patrol, so very much connected with what's happening here tonight with the 10th. Also, thank you to some people. We have a very involved board, but some people rise above in terms of their help. Poppy Gall is the co-chair of our board. Her contribution to this museum, to making this exhibit happen, to promoting it, to making it beautiful. So Poppy is really an integral part of this museum, and it's fantastic positive energy. With Poppy happily comes Mike Catronio, who built our beautiful new exhibit cases, helps us when our bench is having trouble, helps us hang banners. He's a historical preservationist. So how lucky are we to have that? So thank you to him. I'm going to say a quick thank you to my husband, Rob, who, like tonight when he's coming, I have to call and say, could you stop? Because we're out of toilet paper. Stop. So thank goodness for the people supporting us. Meredith's good friend Kyle is here videotaping all of this for us tonight. So thank you as well. Brian Lindner is still downstairs, I think.
No, he left to go on a rescue.
He did go. So there is a rescue. Again, something very close to 10th Mountain Division. A number of people who the connections with the mountain rescues stem from 10th. So he's had to go off tonight. But thank you to him, and we will share that with him also. Moving on, we have this wonderful collaboration for this exhibit. And when I talked about all the thank yous and the teamwork happening here, I will say that I had the best compliment of my whole time working here, which has been since January, and that came from Meredith. As you know, she has been with the museum since it opened its doors here in Stowe, and she created this amazing team. people put together this exhibit that I will thank, and then I'll tell you the compliment. Seth Scanlon from the Fort Drum and Tip Mountain Division, or Seth right here, he'll speak in a minute. Thank you so much. And he also has trained us on how to talk about the exhibit. Colonel Williams right here. He's the assistant chief of staff of the current 10th Mountain Division. So welcome and thank you for being here. And we have Colonel Lord and Major Fry from the Army Mountain Warfare School. Both of them here. Obviously a number of other people who served in our Army and on the 10th Mountain Division. We all appreciate your service and thank you as well. So thank you very much for that. And Meredith put together this team to create this exhibit, which is a work in progress, and your contributions will help us with that. But this morning, when you watch Meredith, she creates this teamwork, but she did say to me this morning that we're a great team. And it's a really, really nice compliment. So it's a teamwork, and I will pass the mic over to Meredith. Thank you all so much for being here.
Go away from the.
Hi, I'm Meredith. Thank you all for coming. I recognize so many of your faces. It's so lovely to have you back. As you know, that in 2003, the museum inducted all of the Vermonters who served in the 10th Mountain Division during World War II, and I know many of you have family and friends who were recognized during that event. The wonderful thing about that was that as part of that, we collected all the stories of those surviving veterans. And those are all currently, thanks to Lisa Beach and that donation for Al Pawlowski, we put together a great website component that had all of their bios and their photos. So we're in the process of taking all the information that we compiled since 2003 and the start of that project, and all the information that we're compiling now, and kind of redoing it. So I think to Deb's point that this is an ongoing project is really important. I did make some copies for people of the brochure we put together in 2003 that lists the names of all of our veterans, and I was reading it yesterday and it all talks about how this is still an ongoing project, and I love the idea that that is still the truth. We have, even today, the Army Mountain Warfare School brought some of the modern ice climbing materials and equipment that's going to be added to the exhibit, and this is encouraging to come back, because what you see tonight is a huge amount of the museum collection that's been donated since 2003, plus things that are keep coming in. And we do have an iPad presentation. We're going to be really modern, so you can really do some compare and contrast and really get some more of the secondary materials into that presentation. So it's been very fun for me to bring that 2003 project back and to include some new partners. And we've had a lot of fun working with the new museums and the Mountain Warfare School and bringing it back to what's happening in Jericho. So I'm really happy to be able to have all of those people present a little, say a few words today, because they're the experts. And like Deb said, I feel like we're just the ones that are bringing everybody together to share with you their expertise. So we have Brian Lindner was going to say a few words. I don't know how many of you know Brian. Probably everybody knows Brian. He's still busy. So what I would encourage you to do is this Thursday. He's busy coordinating. So we're going to let Brian coordinate, because on Thursday he's going to be here doing his presentation on the Mount Mansfield Ski Patrol, which has so many connections to the 10th. And hopefully then he can talk about many of his family artifacts are in this exhibit. So Brian also did all of our research on the Vermonters who were killed in action that you'll see upstairs. So he's a wealth of information, and I think he can probably tie that in on Thursday if people can come back. So
we got involved in the tent because my Christmas present from Chuck in the 2003 was to fund the permanent collection for the tent mount display, and I bawled. We have a ski rep in 1963 when we opened our Alpine shop, and his name was Walter Prager. And he was a man that you didn't know why you were in awe of this man, but you were. And it was an actor that I found how famous he was. And he sold for a thing called Islin Imports, and they were all in the tent mount. And when Islin went out of business, he came into the Alpine shop and took my hand and he said, "Don't forget me." He went with Temco Parkers, and they had 12 in the line. And my husband would laugh every year at the ski show, "Why did you buy those parkers?" I don't know. I can no more not buy those parkers and slit my throat. Look at that man. I have to do it. I found out how famous he was in the tent after he got hung up on the tent. And my Christmas present from Chuck was when we brought the tent really here, and the little small 2.5-foot bronze is here. And I found Gene Traynor, whose husband designed the sculpture. And that sculpture was designed for the men so they wouldn't be forgotten. He spent the last years of his life designing that sculpture, in case anybody here wants to go up the road and see him in all his glory. And he was paid for by $25 donations from each 10th mountain man that could afford it. And it cost $98,000 for those guys to bring him. And so we have the second one in the world. The first one is in Vail. And so we brought him here. And so he got on our land. And the 10th has been... Today, it's not only for the 10th of yesterday, but it's for all of you guys that are out there that are working for us. And we thank you.
Training exercise, we call it Mountain Peak. It's a brigade. brigade level exercise, 4,000 soldiers out fighting right now tonight in this these conditions in classic 10th Mountain Division form. They're preparing for a rotation in February to the Joint Readiness Training Center down at Fort Polk, Louisiana. And then what happens when units go down to Fort Polk, right? It's very funny because it's, you know, it's 15 degrees tonight at Fort Drum, and there's, you know, a foot of snow on the ground, but at Fort Polk, Louisiana, there will be no snow, and it will probably be 60 degrees when they get there. But they'll go through that rotation, and then once they're done with that, the Army will say, you are now once again combat ready to deploy wherever it is that we need you. So General Pyatt is there tonight with 1st Brigade and wishes he could be here, and I thank you very much for allowing me to be here tonight in his stead. So I was going to talk to you a little bit tonight about what 10th Mountain Division is doing now. The current 10th Mountain Division is a little bit different than it was in World War II. The current 10th Mountain Division has 3 brigade combat teams, a division artillery, a sustainment brigade, a combat aviation brigade, and through our associated unit program, we also have a partnership with the 86th Brigade Combat Team right here in Vermont, which you happen to know, I'm sure, the 86th is part of the original lineage of the 10th Mountain Division. So if you let me, I'd like to tell you a little bit about what those brigades have been doing for the last year. 1st Brigade, earlier this year, was the ones who are out right now in the field with General Pyatt. Earlier this year, they went on a 3-week notice, quick. In fact, it was the 1st Battalion of the 87th Infantry Regiment, which y'all all recognize from the original days of 10th Mountain. Three weeks, no notice, go to Afghanistan. They did that, you know, once again. I have been told, as long as I've been in the, since post 9/11, the 10th Mountain Division is the most deployed division in the Army, and the 1st Battalion of the 87th is the most deployed battalion. So they went again this year to Afghanistan, and simultaneously sent 4 companies to Djibouti and Cameroon and in Africa, where they were helping train their forces as well. While they're in Afghanistan, they had 6 of their soldiers decorated for valor. 2nd Brigade, the commandos are the best trained brigade in the Army. Earlier this year, they went through a intensive training cycle to get ready for a no-notice deployment readiness exercise called Vigilant Shield, in which they were no-notice alerted to go to 3 different sites inside the United States to secure critical infrastructure in support of Northern Command, we call it NORTHCOM, just to test the ability to do that, and they did it flawlessly. And then, of course, tonight, 2nd Brigade is deployed to Afghanistan and Kosovo. In Afghanistan, where they're conducting advised assist missions, and in Kosovo, where they're helping with a safe and secure environment. Our 3rd Brigade is actually stationed at Fort Polk, Louisiana. I'm not sure how many people know that. 3rd Brigade used to be at Fort Drum with 10th Mountain Division, with the main part of the division. And then a few years ago, when we had 4 brigades, the 4th Brigade was at Fort Polk, and then a few years ago, they deactivated the 3rd Brigade at Fort Drum and renamed that 4th Brigade. It's down at Fort Polk. They renamed it 3rd Brigade. So the 3rd Brigade is there. Earlier this year, they were in Iraq. They were feared by the enemy, respected by the people, and lived in the dirt, never complained. Classic 10th Mountain, just wonderful soldiers. They're home now, and just like 1st Brigade, in the next chapter, the first year, they'll go through their own mountain peak and their own joint readiness training exercise to once again be ready to deploy. The Combat Aviation Brigade, the best combat aviation brigade in the Army, earlier this year spent, you may have seen this in the news, they sent 6-6 CAB, which is their one of their Apache helicopter units, sent it to Korea, South Korea, as part of the deterrent operations that were going on back when things were getting heated with North Korea. You may remember that. While they were doing that, the rest of the aviation brigade went to Europe and participated in an operation called Atlantic Resolve. And that is where we send, we rotate units over, and they go over just to show presence and to deter aggression there between in Europe and Russia. And they did that, and then came back, and the Army said, hey, we want you to test some of this new equipment, and let us kind of get a sense of what is it that an aviation brigade would need in the future. And so they did that, which is, like, again, classic 10th Mountain, where, you know, we go out and test all the original cold weather gear to see what it is you would need to be able to fight in the cold weather mountains environment. The CAB continues doing that out there with the helicopters. And so they did that when they got home. The exercise was called Falcon Peak. Sustainment Brigade, has been all over the world. Again, they were in Afghanistan and Iraq last year, and they also were at home. You remember the hurricanes that occurred in Houston, the Caribbean, and the one that hit North Carolina? They went to all of them. And then after the one in Houston, they came home and went back to Afghanistan and had one of their companies over there providing mail service for the entire theater. Tonight, they're out with the 1st Brigade in the field supporting their operations as well. And then the division headquarters. The division headquarters was in Iraq last year also with the division artillery, which is the unit that I'll take command of here in about 12 days. And they were there in Iraq. They were there to help secure the peace for the elections. And that happened back in May. The Iraqis held their election with no violence. When for someone who'd been to Iraq 3 times, to see that and to see that progression, that's a good feeling. I was there for the invasion. I was there when it was at its worst in 06. I was there in 11 when we left the first time. And then so to kind of see it the way it is now, it seems to be trending in the right direction. It's encouraging from someone who spent a good part of his life over there, being away from my wife and kids. So, and then the division headquarters, we'll go right. In fact, right after I take command, we begin a train up for a warfighter exercise in the summertime, which is a sort of the division level equivalent of a Joint Readiness Training Center exercise, where once you're done, the Army says, "Okay, you're once again validated, you're ready for combat." So we're excited about being able to go do that. But the 10th Mountain Division's legacy continues to be connected to our World War II past. The division continues to be founded on the toughness of its soldiers, the soldiers who go out and they'll fight in any condition. They really believe it. All this gear that's back here that Seth brought over, the soldiers put that on and they can fight in any condition, and it doesn't matter. The 1st Brigade out tonight, unfazed by having to fight like this. The 10th Mountain Division continues to train new equipment, to train all of the new cold weather gear for the Army to see what works and what doesn't work. In fact, so at our installation, I think the best place to see where this connection is, I don't know if anyone's been to Fort Drum, but the best place to see that connection from our current division to the World War II era of the division is our Memorial Park. Our Memorial Park has 21 bronze plaques has the name of 230 soldiers who were killed in action since the division was reactivated in 1985 at Fort Drum. But the centerpiece of that is the Military Mountaineer statue, 17 feet tall. It's got a World War II era mountaineer on the top, and he's on belay for a current day mountaineer who is climbing to the top to join him. Since the division has been reactivated in 1985, the division motto has been "Climb to Glory." And the response is always "to the top." I'm not one to name drop, but before I was back at I've been in the 10th Mountain Division twice. This is the second time. In between, I went to D.C. and I was on the Joint Staff for 2 years. And when I had that job, I was the Deputy XO to the Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Dunford, who's a Marine. And this evening, I was texting with him. I maintain a relationship with him. I was texting him, telling him I was here to speak on behalf of 10th Mountain Division. And he responded, no hesitation, "to the top." So your brain, you know. So thank you very much for letting me be here. I would especially like to thank Chuck and Jan Perkins. Thank you so very much. Thank you so very much for your support of the division, for allowing me to be here tonight. Thank you to the Vermont Ski and Snowboard Museum for all you've done. The division is honored. Thank you.
Two, the have Mountain Division, like many of the divisions, case their colors. And when we, you know, immediately downsized following the war, and for many years we were divested as a really as a nation of our capability to fight and win in the mountains. We fought in Korea, suffered numerous casualties due primarily to cold weather in a lot of instances, but still, with the exception of a few small schools scattered about the force, didn't really have the capability to fight in the mountains. So in the early 80s, kind of at the height of the Cold War, under the Reagan era, budgets increased, and the idea came back that maybe we need to have this capability. So that the story, as it's told to me, was that at the time, the chief of staff of the Army, General Sullivan, who happened to be a Norwich grad, was up at Jericho at Ethan Allen Firing Range with then our adjutant general, General Don Edwards, who was a classmate of his at Norwich. They both had a personal friendship. And as they watched the biathlon race, which I'm not sure if many of you know, but in Vermont we are the executive agents for the Army's biathlon program. So they watched, you know, military skiers fit young soldiers ski by and shoot targets. And as it was told to me, the chief of staff of the Army turned to General Edwards and said, "Geez, wouldn't that be great if we could have a military unit that could do that?" And General Edwards, you know, famously looked at him and said, "Well, you know, if you give me $2 million in 2 years, you'll have one." And sure enough, 2 years later, and probably $2 million, if not more, knowing General Edwards, he had a mountain infantry company at that time. And a few years later, that company grew into a battalion, 3rd of the 172nd Infantry Battalion, the Mountain Battalion, which had the mission in the Cold War of defending the southern flank of NATO in the Italian Alps, working with the Alpini. And for many years, mountain soldiers from Vermont, Maine, and New Hampshire would go to Italy and train with the Alpini. And because of that unique requirement, the Army Mountain Warfare School was started here. And we're proud here to have Lieutenant Colonel Matt Brown, the commander, and one of the former commanders here, Colonel retired Matt Fitzgerald. So 10 years later, the global war on terror happened. Vermont at the time had an armor brigade, and the Army at the time didn't feel they had to have so many armor brigades, so they divested that capability as well and stood up an infantry brigade. The 86th Mountain Infantry Brigade was born. Roughly 2015, a national commission that was sponsored by Congress to look at readiness of the Army came up with some recommendations, one of which was we need to have closer ties and more interoperability between the active component and the National Guard. So an initiative out of that commission was the Associated Unit Program, by which select National Guard brigades would be paired with active duty divisions. Now, three out of 28 National Guard brigades were chosen, one of which was the 86th Brigade here in Vermont, and we became aligned underneath the 10th Mountain Division as part of the AUP. So we kept the mountain tap, but we took the deer head patch on and put the cross bayonets back on. So in the 86th Brigade, we have six different states, most of which are in New England, but we also have an infantry battalion in Colorado. So the results of that is that the 10th Mountain patch is now worn, is back in Colorado, worn by Colorado National Guardsmen. And in fact, it's our understanding that Colorado was looking at building a armory and training facility right in Leadville, not far from Camp Hale. So pretty exciting times to be in the mountain infantry and be wearing the 10th Mountain patch. But I thought I'd kind of finish by reading something that as a young lieutenant hung in the headquarters of the 3rd Battalion, 172nd Infantry Building. And this is the letter that General Hayes wrote to the entire division the day after the successful assault on Riva Ridge. And it reads, "Officers and men of the 10th Mountain Division, in your first assigned mission, you had the following difficult tasks. Concentrate in a valley overlooked on three sides by the enemy, over an inadequate route not being discovered by the enemy. Seize by night assault the precipitous mountain ranges on your left. Assault by night the enemy's strong defensive line, including the strong points and fortified towns of Verona and Pola. Hold these positions, seized against counterattack, and capture successive objectives, to include the final objective, advance from left to right some 10,000 meters. You accomplished all of your assigned missions with significant dash and determination. You caught the enemy completely by surprise by your movement at night up precipitous slopes through his heavily mined areas and by your destruction of his dugouts and bunkers. You overran and defeated elements of 8 different enemy battalions, parts of 2 divisions plus 2 separate battalions, from which you captured approximately 400 prisoners of war. You accomplished these results with relatively low casualties in comparison to the results achieved. By your actions, you have won the confidence and admiration of all the troops within the theater and the highest praises of your corps, army, army group, and theater commanders. As your division commander, I am very proud of you and salute your courage, determination, fighting spirit, and professional workmanship you have displayed in all sections. Signed, George P. Hayes, Major General, U.S. Army Command. And, the hair on the back of my neck still stands up because I think those words are as important today as they were some 70 years ago, because that really describes the fighting spirit and determination found in being a mountain soldier. Thank you. And now the real treat of the night, we've got Major Nate Fry from the Army Mountain Warfare School.
It means that I can't talk any longer than my boss has just said. So I'll try to make the point quickly. But what I'm going to speak on tonight is something that I think is critically important to think about as we walk around this exhibit tonight and over the coming months as we come into the building and kind of meditate on the history of the tent. Tonight, if we look at a lot of the things here, right, we're going to see a depiction of things that have changed, right? So old rucksacks and new rucksacks, old ice axes and new ice axes, right? So there's a lot of contrast between what was and what the 10th Mountain Division used, nearly 80 years ago, and what we're using today. But I think it's also really important to note and understand what hasn't changed about the 10th Mountain Division from then until now, right? So in my position at the Army Mountain Warfare School, I spent a lot of time thinking about how we train and educate soldiers. And for any educator in the room, I think we would all agree that the way a student turns out, right, is largely a byproduct of the way that we train and educate that student, right? Do we press them into rote memorization where they only learn the facts and then, as a result they can only spit out the facts, or are we trying to get them to learn how to think as opposed to what to think? And come up with innovative solutions to problems. And if you look at the history of the 10th Mountain Division, right, there's the division itself, and then there's also the mountain training group that trained the division back at Camp Hill. And I think it's notable that the 10th Mountain Division was largely, I think, a product of the superior training that the mountain training group provided to them at Camp Hill. And so when we think about the developments that occurred within the 10th Mountain Division, the creation of nylon ropes and innovations that happened with skis and with weaponry mounted on top of skis and vehicles, the proofing of the Weasel vehicle, we see a lot of this creativity, innovation, problem solving coming out of the 10th Mountain Division. And not only did it happen during the war itself, but after the war, when we look at the storied alumni of the 10th Mountain Division, right, we've got guys like Paul Petzl, who went on to create the National Outdoor Leadership School, Bill Bowerman, who founded Nike, right? And so for me, at least, as an educator, looking at how the 10th Mountain Division was trained, what they did in the war, what they produced, and then what they continued to produce after the war, that to me indicates that this was a group of soldiers that wasn't educated by rote memorization and look for the next year, you're going to stand up on your skis and you're going to fall down, you're going to stand up and you're going to fall down, you're going to do that over and over and over again until you're sick of it. There was probably some of that. But more than that, like the mountain training group that was educating these soldiers, educated them in a way so that when the soldiers of the 10th Mountain Division saw an obstacle in front of them, like Riva Ridge, and, oh, by the way, all their equipment was still back in the United States because the logisticians had crossed some things where they hadn't crossed, the soldiers of the 10th Mountain Division said, no big deal. We don't have any air equipment, but we can make it work anyway. And as Colonel Lord just read, they did, and they did it with great success. My job essentially at the Mountain Warfare School is to make sure that as all this equipment changes, that one core aspect of the 10th Mountain Division, the Mountain Training Group, doesn't change. Because that is the hallmark of you know, not only a soldier that can go forward and accomplish the hardest mission, but a soldier who can leave the service and go into civilian life and continues to contribute as a you know, powerful member of society. Because if you look at any military base these days, when soldiers are transitioning, there's a big emphasis that's placed on how do you get that soldier out of the military and transition them into civilian life and help them find their way. And obviously the 10th Mountain Division and the Mountain Training Group did that. So at the Mountain Warfare School, our instructors essentially stop with the rote memorization piece after the students learn their knots, right? And other than that, the Mountain Warfare School, just across the mountain in Jericho, spends a lot of time investing in soldiers and trying to teach them to be problem solvers, creative thinkers, innovators, in the tradition of the 10th Mountain Division, the 10th Mountain Division of old and the 10th Mountain Division of today. So Colonel Williams spent a lot of time telling everyone about what the 10th Mountain is doing throughout the world. And I think there's a reason that they are the most highly deployed unit in the entire United States Army. Right? Because people recognize that the individual soldiers of the division understand how to solve problems and be creative and innovative and not just A plus B plus C plus D type formula. So the Mountain Warfare School of today is looking back to the past of the Mountain Training Group and constantly trying to understand how we can create that type of soldier and continue that tradition forward. Even though all the equipment has changed, the one thing that we realize that we cannot let go is understanding the type of training, the type of education that creates that type of soldier. And so, although you've kind of heard a litany of words here tonight from leaders of the 10th Mountain Division, leaders within the Mountain Warfare School, I'm going to embarrass a few guys who are standing back in the back and have no uniform on, but we've got Paul Galetta, Andrew Jolinas, and Tom Contos. You guys can raise your hands and wave, right? So three instructors at the Army Mountain Warfare School today who spend a lot of their time trying to figure out how they can continue to produce soldiers of the same quality, the same caliber, the same level of outstanding initiative that the Mountain Training Group did some 80 years ago. So I'll kind of leave you with this note, right? As you're walking around the exhibit and you look at pictures of 10th Mountain Division soldiers, right? You just kind of look at the looks on their faces. If you notice like a little something different about them, take a look at their eyes, because you know, when I look at these guys, I see a spark in their eyes, and it's a spark of innovation, it's a spark of creativity, and to be honest, there's a certain bit of rebellion, you know, hidden there as well, because that's what good mountaineers do. They know when to practice disciplined disobedience. So take a look at that and remember that, because I think it's easy to get caught up in the idea of changing equipment, but I would hope everyone understands that we do recognize that the one special thing about the 10th Mountain Division can't be manufactured. It has to be passed on from one generation of soldier to another generation of soldier, and the Mountain Warfare School of today is continuing to do that within all the soldiers and students that come through our gates. So thank you for coming out tonight.
Thank you for that. Brian Lindner is
my background for the 10th is that I'm a descendant. My dad and all my uncles were in the 10th Mountain Division. And looking around, I see other descendants. Descendants, want to raise your hand? Yeah, there's a few of us here.
We're going to be opening an exhibit about
they are as much loved by the modern 10th as they are by the historic 10th. Coming, everybody.